Hello and welcome to Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading. Today we are going to analyze The Hindu, dated 11th of October 2019. Displayed on the screen is the list of articles that we are going to discuss today. Timestamping for the same has been provided in the description. Let's begin.
We have taken this news from page number 1 and it talks about India slams Turkey for Syria action. Now it is important to understand that this will fall under General Studies Paper 2. Especially under international relations. As a subtopic, it may come under something which is like affecting India's interests. It is also important to understand that this topic is more important for prelims examination and important locations, cities and places as mentioned in the article of Turkey and Syria are important from the prelims perspective. We have seen similar questions in the previous year. Let's take one example. In 2018, there was a question, consider the following pairs of towns sometimes mentioned in the news and we have to find the correct match. First is Aleppo, second is Kirkuk, third is Mosul and fourth is Mazar-e-Sharif. The correct answer for this question is option B, that is 1 and 4. It means Aleppo, Syria and Mazar-e-Sharif in Afghanistan were correctly matched. From this perspective, you need to pay attention to all the important locations that we are going to discuss in this article. Now, before moving further, let's talk about the context of this news. Now, this news has become important from the UPSC perspective because India has condemned the military attack by Turkey on Kurdish stronghold of Rojava. Now, important here is to understand that this location is important from the perspective of prelims examination. India has declared Turkey's action as a blow to territorial integrity and sovereignty of Syria. It is also important here to understand that Turkey supported Pakistan on the Kashmir issue in the UN General Assembly summit. This might be one of the reasons why India has slammed Turkey for its action on Syria. Now it is also very important that why this has happened now. US has recently declared withdrawal of troops from northern regions of Syria, where it has been supporting Kurdish-led SDF forces. And these forces were a strong force to fight against Islamic State or IS. On 6th of October, US has declared that it is withdrawing from Syria. As soon as US withdrew, Turkey has sprung into action in a bid to arrest growing Kurdish aspiration of self-government, especially in the Rojava area, which is bordering southern Syria. Turkey launched a military offensive named Operation Peace Spring, targeting the Kurdish militia named People's Protection Force, or commonly called as YPG Militia. India has strongly condemned Turkey's move as an attack to the sovereignty of Syria. Now, before moving further, let's highlight some of the important locations in the map. In the first map, you can see Kurdish settlement and the number of Kurds in each country. Now, we can see that Kurds are spread in Syria, in Turkey, in Armenia, Iran, and Iraq. This makes Kurds the largest ethnic group in the region. It also highlights the population. We can see that 14.7 million Kurds are there in Turkey. 1.7 million Kurds are there in Syria. In Iraq, the number is 5.5 million and in Iran, 8.1 million. Now let's pay attention to the second map. In this map, we can see that Turkey. We can see Kurds Rojava. Apart from that, important locations are Idlib, Manjib, Afrin and Deir az-Zor, Raqqa and Ain Issa are also very important. Please keep a note of these locations so that you can use it for answering the questions correctly in the prelims examination. Now let's go back to our analysis. Now in order to understand the Turkey-Syria conflict, it is important to understand the important stakeholders. The first and the most important stakeholders are the Kurds themselves. Now as I already mentioned, they are fourth largest and the largest stateless ethnic group in the Middle East. They are spread in Turkey, Syria, Armenia, Iraq, and Iran. Now, it is also important to understand the post-World War I, the boundaries of oil-rich Middle East were redrawn according to Treaty of Sevres. However, this treaty failed to carve out a state for Kurds and as a result of which they were dispersed. The Kurds have been demanding the state of Kurdistan for a very long period of time, and this demand is actually the problem between Turkey and Syria. As already mentioned, there are many Kurds in Turkey, and Turkey feels threatened by the idea that Kurds in Syria are getting autonomy. Second important stakeholder is YPG militia. Now, it is important to understand that YPG is a Kurdish militia and is considered the integral part of Syrian Democratic Forces. The Syrian Democratic Forces has been instrumental in defeating IS Caliphate in Syria. At the same time, it is also important to understand that Syrian Kurds of Rojava, which is in the northeastern region of Syria, they are actually leading a semi-autonomous government. YPG is the military arm of this semi-autonomous government, and hence Turkey considers this as a threat. Now, we need to understand the regional power dynamics. Turkey wants to carve out a safe zone between its southern border and Rojava region. Moreover, it is also important to understand that as YPG becomes more powerful, it will bring instability in the region. Turkey is well aware of this, and that is why it wants to take a preventive action in the region. As far as Kurds are concerned, Kurds see this as an ethnic cleansing which is targeted against them by the Turkish forces. Now, we need to understand more about the Turkey's action. Actually, YPG militia group is associated with Kurdish Workers' Party, which is also called as PKK. This political party is banned in Turkey. Since Turkey has banned this party, PKK, it is also acting against YPG because it is armed militia. Turkey also considers PKK as a separatist organization, which is demanding for autonomy since 1980. Now, it has been seen that Kurds have acquired democratic autonomy in Syria, and this threatens Turkey as well. Turkey feels that inspired by the democratic autonomy of Syria, Turkish Kurd may also ask for autonomy. And this is the reason why Turkey is going against the Kurds. Now, it is important here to understand the possible impact of such movement. As already mentioned, YPG was an integral force of US-backed SDF that has defeated ISIS in Syria. While ISIS Caliphate is defeated, ISIS fighters are still holding ground, waiting an opportunity to strike back. Besides, Rojava is home to detention center of IS terrorists, whose force may be unleashed in the event of fall of YPG, bringing back the war situation in Syria. Hence, this position is very important for all those states which are affected by terrorism. And hence, this news is important for India as well. We have taken this article from page number 10, and it talks about an important issue of road safety. Now, as far as this news is concerned, it will be part of General Studies Paper 2 under the topic Governance. As far as subtopic is concerned, it will be covered under Government Policies and Intervention for Development of Various Sectors and Issues Arising out of their design and implementation. This topic is very important for your mains examination. Now, before understanding the nitty-gritty of the article, let's first understand the context. Government of India has recently brought changes through the Motor Vehicle Amendment Bill 2019. This has brought significant changes in the Motor Vehicle Act of 1988. Now, we need to understand that there has been hardly any change, and the 1988 Act was not in tune with the kind of transport revolution that we have seen, especially after the LPG reforms of 1991. Before going through the author's perspective on the issue, let's first understand the need of bringing the amendments. As already mentioned, the Motor Vehicle Act came into operation in the year 1988. For 31 years, there were hardly any changes. This is quite a significant period of time, as we know that in the last 31 years, we have seen a transport revolution. Over and above that, the priorities of government have changed, and now road safety is one of the top priority of the government. In 2015, WHO-sponsored Brasilia Declaration, in which India was also a participant. This has created an obligation on India to reduce the number of fatalities and accidents by half by 2020. This is also part of Sustainable Development Goals 3.6. Now, we need to understand that road safety is an important issue at hand. In 2015, India has seen more than 5 lakh road accidents. In 2017, the number of people who lost their life in road accident is in excess of 1.5 lakh. This is equal to the number of Afghan people who lost their lives after 9/11 terror attacks. Statistically, India is not a very safe place for people who are traveling on road, considering the fact 9 accidents take place every 10 minutes. Moreover, we also know that 50% of the cases are not even being reported. So it means that the problem of road safety is huge, and because of this, government has made necessary changes to the Motor Vehicle Act. Now let's just understand what are the kind of changes government has introduced in the Motor Vehicle Act. Now, some of the changes which are done in the Motor Vehicle Act include higher compensation for the road accidents. Now, people who have faced road accident, it has been seen that they get very low insurance, and this makes their rehabilitation or their dependents much more difficult. And hence, higher compensation for road accident has been put forward through these amendments. Second, roads are used by many type of people, not only people who are using vehicles, but also pedestrians. Through this Road Safety Amendment Bill, we have tried to ensure all those who are using roads. Third aspect is Motor Vehicle Accident Fund was generated. Formulation of National Transport Policy was done. Setting up of the Road Safety Board was done. Good Samaritan Law was also strengthened. And higher fines for traffic violation was introduced. Now, author basically talks about higher fines as penalty. Now, author basically talks about higher fines as a deterrent. For this end, author basically highlights the question, will higher fines solve the problem? For this end, author raises question, will higher fines solve the problem? Now, author basically highlights that road accidents are caused by multiple factors, which include human error, road condition, and vehicle condition. It is true that by implementing higher fines, we may reduce human error, but we need to take into account road condition as well as vehicle condition. Otherwise, this problem won't be solved. Another very important factor is design of roads. Now, for roads, we need proper width, appropriate warning, and proper traffic management to promote good behavior. It has also been seen that the roads which are straight and monotonous in nature, drivers may fall asleep, and this may also cause accidents. And hence, designing of roads is a very important factor in reducing road accidents and ensuring road safety. Another feature that we have seen that national highways are also connecting points for small villages and cities. And we have seen that slow moving traffic enters into the national highways, and this causes many accidents. We need proper barricades and compound walls along such stretches where the villages and the cities connect with the national highways. And we need to prevent the mix of traffic as much as possible, especially on the national highway. So the next point that becomes important is how to improve road safety if higher penalty as a deterrent has a limited value. Now, for this purpose, author suggests that we need to have a holistic and comprehensive approach. Author is of the opinion that penalizing the driver will not solve this problem, as it has been seen in many developed countries. Studies have shown that there's hardly any correlation between road safety and higher fines. So we need to have orderly development and management of roads. We need to ensure safer vehicles. For this purpose, the government has mandated inclusion of airbags in all cars. Over and above that, we need to have a modern traffic management system, and we need to improve the design and construction and maintenance of the road. Now, as far as design and construction is concerned, we need to actually pay attention to the previous topic where the road was highlighted as a very important factor in reducing the accidents. Apart from increasing fines and other changes, we need to change the behavior of drivers. So road safety is a multidisciplinary thing, and we need to do much more than increasing fines. We need to actually incorporate changes which are behavioral in nature. Now, as far as drivers are concerned, we need to go for awareness campaign, as we have seen in Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. It is very important to inculcate right kind of behavioral changes in the drivers, and this in long run will ensure road safety and reduction in fatalities. Over and above, people should take pride in driving right and drive in accordance to the rules. Second important aspect is improvement of infrastructure. As far as infrastructure is concerned, we need to focus not only about roads, but also about layout and design of the roads. Government has much bigger role in ensuring road safety, and this includes construction, maintenance, and auditing the roads that we prepare. Over and above, the government need to set the right type of guidelines, not only for behavioral change, improvement of infrastructure, but also about incorporating technology for ensuring smooth flow of traffic. Education sector is also very important. We need to train our younger generation about right way of driving, and for this purpose, road safety should be part of school curriculum. This younger generation, if it appreciates road safety and safe driving, in the future, this problem will automatically be solved. Over and above, role of media in educating people about what are the right ways to drive and how to drive safely is also highlighted. Role of health sector is also very important, because in cases of accidents, the golden hour or the first hour after accident is very important. We need to get right kind of health facilities available along the national highways so that all those people who meet any kind of accident can get immediate treatment and relief. This will save life and above all, the human resource. With this, let's move to the next news. We have taken this news from page number 8 of today's newspaper, and it talks about invasive weed threatening tiger habitats in Adilabad. As far as this topic is concerned, this will come under General Studies paper 3, and it will come under the heading of environment. As a subhead, it will come under the conservation. Now, this topic is important not only for mains but also for prelims. As we have seen that UPSC has asked various questions on water hyacinth and eucalyptus in the past. Now, this question, which we have actually highlighted on the screen, this question was asked in 2018 prelims examination, and it talks about what is a plant called Prosopis juliflora, often mentioned in news. Now, as far as this plant is considered, this plant is also an exotic plant, and it was brought by British almost 100 years back. This plant is native to Mexico, and here this is also an alien plant in Indian ecosystem. So the correct answer is option B. It tends to reduce the biodiversity in the area in which it grows. Now let's begin our discussion. Now let's first take up the news. Hyptis and Parthenium have spread in the Kadam forest, which is in the Adilabad district, and this weed is threatening the pastures on which animals feed. This in long run may be the reason for man-animal conflict. Now from the perspective of UPSC, please keep the name of these weeds in your mind, which is Hyptis and Parthenium, and in which area they are normally spread. Also remember that these weeds are native to tropical Americas, and now they are threat to the biodiversity in the Adilabad district, especially in the Kadam forest area, which is mentioned in the news. Now, in the light of this discussion, we need to actually understand the importance of invasive alien species. We need to understand what are invasive alien species and how they influence the biodiversity of an area. As far as invasive alien species are considered, they are actually plants, animals, or other organisms which invade the area outside their natural range. And characteristic feature of these alien species is that they negatively impact biodiversity, ecosystem, or human well-being. These alien species are one of the biggest causes of biodiversity loss and species extinction, and are also a global threat to food security and livelihood. It is also important to understand that the absence or lack of natural enemy or predators is the reason for the flourishing of these alien species in the invaded area. Now, it is also important to understand that climate change facilitates the invasion of alien species in the new territories. Climate change reduces the resilience of habitats to biological invasions. Keeping this in mind, it is essential that invasion of these alien species should be incorporated into climate change policy. This includes biosecurity measures to prevent the introduction of invasive alien species to new regions as a result of climate change, and rapid response measures to monitor and eradication of alien species that may become invasive due to climate change. We also need to understand the reasons for this problem. First and foremost is the increased movement or globalization. According to the journal Nature Communication, 1/3 of all the introduction in past 200 years. It is also important to understand the cause of this problem. Now, the cause of this problem is increased movement. Over the past few decades, globalization has increased the movement of people and goods around the world. This has led to the increased number of species introduced outside natural habitats. It is estimated that 1/3 of total species are introduced after 1970. And when we are talking about the total species, we are talking about 200 years from present. Now, the invasion of alien species is closely related to climate change. Now, extreme climate change can transport alien species to new areas. Extreme climate changes like hurricanes, floods, etc. can transport invasive species to new areas and decrease the resistance of habitats to invasion. It is important for us to understand the impact of these alien species on the local ecosystems. The increase and geographic redistribution of invasive species will have diverse societal and environmental impacts. Biological invasions are a major threat to global food security and livelihood, especially with the developing countries. Developing countries, which have high level of subsistence and smallholder farming, often lack the capacity to prevent and manage biological invasions. According to an estimate, the economic cost of the management of these alien species only for insects has touched $70 billion in 2016. It shows that developing countries are at bigger risk from these invasive alien species. Now, in the PDF of this video, we have included a list of invasive alien species for some plants and animals which are important from the perspective of examination. Please go through that list and keep a mental note about important alien species that may be asked in the examination. Let's move to the next news. We have taken this news from page number 2 of today's newspaper, and it talks about annual Ganga River dolphin census begins. Now, this news is important from the perspective of prelims examination, and it will come under environment and ecology. From the perspective of the mains examination, it will be part of general studies paper 3, and it will be part of biodiversity and will be covered under conservation. Let's try to understand important facts about gangetic dolphins. First and foremost, gangetic dolphins are declared national aquatic animal by the Ministry of Environment and Forest. Dolphins are categorized under 3 heads. First is freshwater, second is brackish water, and third is marine dolphins. All 3 category of dolphins are accorded highest conservation status, and they are mentioned in Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act 1972. There are a total of 15 species of marine and harbor dolphins which are reported from Indian water and coast. Moreover, Irrawaddy dolphin is found in brackish water of Odisha. It is important here to mention that Irrawaddy dolphin was asked in the prelims examination in the recent past, and we have discussed this question in our previous videos. Indus River dolphin is found in Indus River in Punjab. It is important here to mention that gangetic dolphin is one among the 17 species identified for taking up recovery program of critically endangered species under centrally sponsored scheme of integrated development of wildlife habitat.
Now, based on today's discussion, let's take a practice question. What does Brasilia Declaration deals with? A. Reducing greenhouse gas emissions. Second, protection of women rights. Third is promotion of road safety. And fourth is Amazon forest. The correct answer is option C, as this is related to road safety. Moreover, Brasilia Declaration was sponsored by WHO in 2015. Second question is, consider the following pairs of tiger reserves and the states. Tiger reserves are Kaval and Telangana, Dandeli Ansi in Tamil Nadu, Tadoba and Maharashtra. If you have been following the recent discussions on Rao's ISDNS channel, then you would know that correct answer is statement 1 and 3, which is mentioned in option C. Dandeli Ansi is part of Karnataka. Practice question number 3, where in India we can find Irrawaddy dolphin? Now, this question was part of the prelims examination as well, as we have discussed in the discussion. The correct answer for this is option B, that is brackish water of Odisha. Let's move to practice question number 4. Consider the following statements about the Motor Vehicle Amendment Act of 2019. First, it has led to higher fines on traffic violation. This is correct. Second is, it provides for protection of Good Samaritan in case of accident. This is also correct. And third is, it empowers central government to develop national transportation policy. This is also correct. So correct answer in this case is option D, 1, 2 and 3. With this, we have come to the end of today's discussion. Let's move to the question of the day.